put off by how long this video is. Don't worry, I try to jam-pack my videos with as much content and as much detail as I possibly can. Anything I feel I can comment on and that I feel you might be interested in, I pretty much put in the video. I try not to repeat myself and talk fairly fast. If the video is too long for you, I have recorded a shorter version and the link will be in the description box. Captain America Civil War movie review. It has been 1 year since Age of Ultron came to an end, and when another international incident with collateral damage occurs, governments around the world, through the UN, try to manage the Avengers rather than them operating without any overview of, basically, as it has been since the end of Captain America 2, the Winter Soldier, they've been operating entirely on their own. They're not answering to anyone. And basically, this, through certain circumstance, Captain America ends up basically let's say defending the Winter Soldier, whereas Iron Man, he wants, you know, he wants it to be processed. He wants it to be done through this, yeah, the Sokovia Accords. Rather, you know, in the comics, it's Superhero Registration Act, either SRA or SHRA, Superhero Registration Act. In this, it's the Sokovia Accords. Basically, I will get into that. Some said of the, you know, Captain America 2. I'm gonna go with number because the Winter Soldier is an actual character in both movies, so it's gonna get confusing. Captain America 2, some said that it went too far in its social commentary and, you know, it ended up toothless. I would say this one fares better in that department. I don't agree that it ended up toothless, but yeah, this one doesn't go, yeah. And I'm not going to give anything away, but for sure the third act in this is very much, there is a personal kind of, yeah, between the parties involved. Now, with the Phase 2 movies having been this kind of world-ending stuff, you know, this movie shows us what happens when, over and over, it looks like the world is going to end. You know, sooner or later, the governments of the world are actually going to get together and try to control the thing that had the, yeah, that seemed to keep causing the end of the world. You know, get some kind of, yeah, control. And Captain America and Steve and Tony have basically swapped views. As, you know, I mean, in Iron Man 1, Tony does talk about accountability, but he's talking about he wants to hold himself accountable, you know. And yeah, in this, as in the comics, they swap views in this particular storyline. And with the with the Accords, they split Steve and some of the others split away from the main Avengers, and we have more than one team of Avengers, which is a first for the MCU, but the comics, there are a number of different teams. And it's, it's kind of whether or not can the Avengers trust in the government? They tried that before, didn't work out with Shield, so it's not the same kind of, they're not going to run into the same situation as they did there, but nevertheless, Steve did try trusting in the government, and yeah. And maybe a distant, isolated prison complex will be utilized. And maybe someone will, switch teams at one point. And it's basically, going into the themes of liberty, moral responsibility, civil order, and it does not provide any easy answers. And to respond to one hilarious criticism that I've actually seen online. Here, as in the comics, it's basically Steve and Tony representing the two different sides. And in both cases, they, of course, gather support from the other, I'm gonna go with costumed characters. And yeah, in this, they bring together just about every single costume character that they could, conceive, ones that have been set up and ones that are, yeah. Obviously, in the comic books, there are more costumed characters. When you're putting out a lot of comic books and a ton of them actually exist in the same continuity and universe, yeah, you can have a lot more costume characters in there than when you're putting out, maybe a movie per year with actors and, it's with if two dozen costume characters appear in a single scene in a comic book, that means that the people in charge have to draw them and write for them. If they have to be in a movie, they have to, cast people, costuming it. Yeah. Anyway, the Winter Soldier, it's difficult to, you don't quite know where he's going to land, who he's going to side with. This does have a villain. He hasn't really been in like trailers and TV spots much, and basically it's not some super powerful guy, and it's not like a huge, he doesn't have a huge group of people behind him or anything. He's fine. It's basically that they kind of needed there to be someone there. You'll see why when you watch. I'm not gonna give away. But the villain is there from the start. It's not, you know, not like in Batman versus Superman. The villain is in one of the very first scenes. You meet him very early on, and then just, you know, every so often we see what he's doing and we figure out what he's working on and such. Now, where, you know, the first Captain America movie was basically the US, you know, rescuing rescuing Europe from, as Nostalgia Chick points out, not the Nazis, but Hydra. Definitely not the Nazis. And then with Captain America 2, you know, it's kind of home front, kind of stuff, you know, it's civil rights. And in this, it's also basically civil rights. Doing last minute notes. A question that you really have to get into when it comes to this movie is it worth watching just for Spider-Man? Yes, yes it is. Watch it. If you have even the tiniest, unless you like cannot stand the MCU and the rest of these characters, if you have even a tiny, if there's any part of you that at all likes Spider-Man, watch this movie. He's not in a ton of it, but he's amazing in every second he's in. And, you know, if this is, you know, if you're not really familiar with the MCU, this is not like Age of Ultron. You do have to, you cannot quite pick up everything that you need to know. This movie does kind of expect you to know the basic, you know, the core characters and if you're just now getting into the MCU, watch Age of Ultron. That'll, you know, give you an idea of who everyone is. And yeah, then you can watch this and you won't really have to, you know, there'll be one or two things that weren't in that movie, but that you, yeah. I should say that for after. There's a fun little General Ross in this has almost this kind of, like, he's that frustrating, you know, hard ass, you know, boss character. He's the, you know, yeah, police chief or something. Just, you know, literally there's a, just give me 72 hours. You have 36. And yeah. This has some kind of, there are some things in this that happen specifically because of the whole Snowden kind of thing that has happened in the MCU. There's this, I've already mentioned that, you know, Steve is fighting for, I'm going to go with Bucky again, instead of just, And I'm going to assume that you know, if you don't already know the names that correspond to which characters and such, open a wiki or something in the other tab. Just, yeah. I'm going to go by the idea that you can follow it, nevertheless. Given that Steve fights to protect Bucky some of the time, there's some real, like, Terminator 2 kind of stuff where they have to, like, deal with actual cops who aren't, like, you know, they're not, they just, yeah. So they have to not kill them. And it's just, yeah, it's fun, and it's also, you know, just reassuring that they can still, you know, it matters who they're fighting. They can be fighting good guys and not be going for the kill. Although Steve does have to keep Bucky kind of like, yeah, Bucky is maybe not as determined. And this movie actually opens with the first real action scene we get in this is very similar to the first real action scene in The Amazing Spider-Man 2. And I don't know if, Age of Ultron, the entire climax is basically saying, see, Man of Steel, this is how you do it. I don't know if the entire intro here is also supposed to be kind of a thing to Amazing Spider-Man 2. Yeah, they're somewhat more careful that that people don't get hurt from. Yeah. And the movie is 2 hours and 18 minutes, not counting the end credits, and you definitely want to stay through the end credits. And yeah, there's a mid-credits, sequence. That one's amazing. That's not all. There are two. There is one at the end. Every single time, a bunch of people leave. I don't know. I hope that they, like, look it up or get, like, a recap from someone, because they're missing gold. Stay through the end credits. It's beyond worth it. And yeah, the opening, you see that we hadn't really seen it particularly before, but in this you do really see that, yeah, the Avengers can actually work as just this kind of, you know, covert ops spy kind of outfit. You know, I mean, you, I don't know, actually maybe it's because it's the Russos, you know, it's similar to Captain America 2, you know, but yeah, it's because in this one you do genuinely have all of them. Like, you'll, you know, one of the very first things you'll see in this is actually, you know, Scarlet Witch blending in, and this kind of, and it's like, yeah, it just, it kind of takes you by surprise. But, you know, I mean, like I said, it's been a year since Age of Ultron. Yeah, there's been time for her to, you know, train for that kind of thing. So, Sam Jackson as Nick Fury, the incestuous Maximoff, I'm going with Maximoff, twins, physically assaulting Hank Pym. Yeah, this really is the ultimate universe, you know, Mark Millar's version of the Marvel universe, or as I like to call it, Ma-ilar-less. The, you know, this goes into whether or not the heroes could, you know, whether they're responsible for collateral damage, and, you know, if they should be able to limit it and such. And, you know, really limiting collateral damage has been in the MCU from the very start. It's just at this point, you know, with Age of Ultron and this, it's really the focus, you know. And I've seen some, like, online, you know, say, oh, but in the future, how can we, you know, the next time we see Hulk kick a guy through a wall, we will feel bad for laughing. The whole thing of, like, current, you know, comic book adaptation films and collateral damage, Renegade Cut and Folding Ideas did a far better job of going into that, and did so when it was relevant. Try not to be a sourpuss about everything. Seriously, the MCU has done fairly well as far as, you know, they don't always avoid collateral damage, but they acknowledge it and they try to limit it. Now, Civil War, the storyline, is one of the most known comic, you know, widely known comic book storylines to star Captain America. You know, even if you know almost nothing, like, when, I mean, yeah, I read Civil War when it came out, and the moment that I heard that they were doing Civil War, you know, it's one of those storylines where the moment you hear, oh, that, you know, so, yeah, it makes sense that they would go for adapting that as well. And, you know, it does really, the comic and this film just work as really compelling post-7/11 criticism. And I was wondering if it was gonna be like, would the story happen including the law passing, and, you know, then getting drama from that, or would it be a slippery slope fallacy? Because a lot of these, you know, they show the, you know, these movies that adapt famous comic storylines, they can show the very start and the very end of things, but they don't really have time within a separate movie, excuse me, to show, you know, a long passing of time where, again, in comic books, you know, if a comic, let's say a storyline takes place over 6 books, time can pass in between those 6, whereas when you're sitting and watching a just over 2-hour movie, you know, it can't really start and stop and skip ahead in time too much like that. But yeah, it does actually, the law is just about passed very early on, and then it's just a matter, you know, like, a number of times they go into, you know, it's a lot of Tony telling Steve, sign it, you know. And that's something that I think is noteworthy. I'm going to be comparing this some to Batman versus Superman, and in this, they talk a lot. They don't just punch, and they keep trying to bring it back to, you know, Tony really wants Steve to sign, and Steve really doesn't. They don't, you know, they don't think that fighting will solve it. It's a last kind of yeah, it's if nothing else can resolve the conflict, then they will fight. And the you know, I remember reading some were a little afraid that like the climax would be just this, you know, just this average little airport. That is an amazing scene, but it's not the climax. And yes, the climax is amazing. And there are actually a lot of locations in this. You know, every and it'll always tell you, you know, big white text across the screen tells you exactly the, you know, city, I want to say. I don't remember the details. I just remember seeing and then being like, ah, that's where we are. Pretty almost must be city. So, you know, it's you know, if maybe that's what Batman v Superman should have had, since they certainly didn't want to do a lot of establishing shots. And the, you know, in both Avengers films, the, you know, there was a little bit of violence between the different ones. They, you know, they didn't really get along. But this is the first time that there's a real, like, major conflict that, yeah, really does not, you know, yeah. And once again, I have to point out, Avengers 1 is literally the only MCU film that Tony is in where it is in no way his fault. That's, yeah. And the, you know, this, yeah, this split down the middle of the Avengers. Zack Snyder and his fanboys, the reason why the conflict here is compelling is not that guys in suits punch each other a lot. It's that it's two opposing sides of an actual interesting conflict. The and yeah, I've already I'm not going to excuse I'm not going to apologize for making cracks at the expense of Batman v Superman. That movie got my money and 2.5 hours of my life. So yes, thankfully, this movie is shot in color. The and, you know, the sort of, in this case, you can't quite say titular fight, but yeah, the fight between Tony and Steve is epic. And yeah, that's another, you know, if you're just like, whatever else about the movie, do they, you know, is it cool to watch the, you know, a fight between, yes, although if, you know, if you're only going for the fight, just know that it's, you know, it's not the conflict. Most of the time, they really do see if they can't resolve it without hurting anyone, including, you know, their friends. So they don't want, but, you know, if you just want to see the, you know, the good guys beat up the good guys they don't agree with, then yes, that is also well worth watching for. There's actually... Vision, now that he's, you know, last time we saw him, he had just joined. So now we see him when he's been, you know, trying to just be a part of the team. You know, like, he's basically an android, and he's young. And so he's trying to fit in, and, like, I'm not going to give too much away, but basically just, he wears normal clothes to kind of try to fit in, and it's just, it's such a fun contrast between these normal looking clothes and then the big red, you know, purplish colored face. And yeah, but he tries, he really does try to just be, you know, to not be weird, and to, yeah, to be comfortable to be around. The With the fight between Cap and Iron Man, there is, of course, that Iron Man can fly and can shoot, whereas Cap, you know, only has the shield. But then, you know, maybe Bucky can come in and kind of help even that out. Maybe Black Panther is a very, very clear match, or at least rival, for Cap. Although there's obviously less history there, but they do find a way to make it rather compelling as a, yes. There aren't really any, like, really hugely unfair matchups in the, you know, if there are situations where, you know, when it comes to the good guys fighting the good guys that they disagree with, you know, there are situations where there's someone that's maybe, you know, difficult for one other person to really deal with, then they have, you know, maybe several people go in and try to deal with that person, and yeah. And the MCU, you know, basically every MCU film changes something, and the ones with a lot of characters change a lot. And yeah, this one does, you know, and especially the relationships between the featured characters. And you know, like with Age of Ultron, you know, a lot will change, and there are a lot of things that are different from the way they were the last time we saw these, yeah. And you know, Steve fights very much for the good he sees in others, and he is certain there is still good in Bucky, and Iron Man fights more to punish and stop evil, as you know, he saw that he himself was doing evil, and then he stopped the evil he was doing. And excuse me, since then he's been stopping other people, excuse me, doing evil. And both Captain America 2 and this Captain America 3 can be called, you know, Avengers 1.5 and Avengers 2.5. Really, considering the full title and the ending of the first Captain America movie, you might call that one Avengers 0.5. And yeah, in the first one, he was specifically fighting for the US military and thus the US government. And in these two, he's fighting, you know, he's maybe fighting some outside of the system and having to face former colleagues. And, you know, we again have Tony trying to build something, trying to create a system to deal with the, you know, the problems that, yeah, Tony tries to build his way out of his problems. That's, you know, that came especially to the forefront in Iron Man 3 and Age of Ultron. Now, as far as for a part 3 of a trilogy, I suppose the main real difference from the first two is that it is legitimately, you know, Steve fighting the people he used to fight alongside. You know, I a lot of people hated both Iron Man 3 and The Dark Knight Rises, and I can see the problems. But they're not my favorites of, like, the series and such, but, you know, I would say that, you know, when it comes to a trilogy, you have the sort of start, you know, maybe origin story, you know, the second part, it's an adventure when the, you know, and then in the third one, you know, you go back to the start, you subvert some expectations, you have less of the protagonist in the suit. You know, in both, in Iron Man and, you know, the Nolanverse, in the second movie, we got a lot of the protagonist in the suit. And yes, Iron Man 2 is crap. Nevertheless, the Iron Man trilogy does work as a trilogy. The core conflict, I was always a little unsure of how exactly they were going to do it, because it doesn't really, at the end of the day, they did have to, they are fighting for a for something other than the whole Accords situation. It's just that there's something else going on. And, you know, if you go into this hoping that it will be first and foremost about, you know, what happened, it's the movie and the conflict is more about what happens when you try to bring in, you know, bureaucracy and the government and the law into something where it wasn't before, then, you know, what exactly do these, you know, particular costume characters do when you bring in the law and such? It's more kind of the principle of the thing, and yeah, and you know, if you go into it specifically for, like, this is not, where the second movie was very much this kind of, the second one is very much about a specific system, and it holds up as just, you know, if you watch, you know, like, it's essentially a political spy thriller. It just happens to have, you know, people with, yeah, like, it just happens that one of the main characters has a metal arm and another is incredibly fast, strong, and tough. You know, this isn't quite that. This, basically, this could happen without the whole kind of, yeah, you know, you could take the Accords out of this movie and still make it work, whereas there's no way you're taking the overall system that they're fighting in the second movie out of that movie without ripping everything else out with it. This is less like, in both Iron Man 3 and Age of Ultron, a lot of people were really frustrated by Tony's actions and his judgment, and I understand it, but nevertheless it is quite accurate to him. This is how, you know, he's not the most emotionally mature person. He's, you know, kind of arrogant, and he makes mistakes from that. That is less the case here than in those. And, you know, some have wondered why Tony is back at all. You know, he quit at the end of Age of Ultron and Iron Man 3. And really, you know, I thought maybe it would be like just hand-waved away the way, you know, Thor being on Earth in Avengers 1 was. And you could maybe say that it's not. There's a little bit of, I think retconning is the word, but there is an actual, you know, he's back mainly because of politics. He really wants to, you know, yeah, he's trying to make sure that this, you know, that the Accords go through. And there's, in both this and the comics, he is approached by someone who lost someone. And that is kind of the you know, major drive, major motivation for him in both. Now, you know, another thing was that in, like, you know, War Machine is also in this, but he also was, you know, like, he wasn't really a main part of the Avengers in Age of Ultron, but, you know, and having just rewatched Iron Man 1 and, you know, owning the, you know, you can see it, owning the DVD, watching the deleted scenes, Terrence Howard, he came so close, and yet he was so far away from being badass in an Iron Man film. And, you know, also back is Hawkeye, who quit for reasons that you'll know if you watched the movie that gave the reasons, and otherwise I'm not going to give them away. Yeah, it's again kind of, you know, that they say why he's back, but it's, yeah, I don't know if it was some kind of, I haven't paid a lot of attention to, like, contract negotiate, you know, news about that, but I can imagine it was something with that, yeah. And, you know, in the comics, Thor and Ragnarok are integral, and yeah, they're not in this. I wondered if maybe Vision would, you know, kind of take, you know, fill that role, given that, for those who don't know too much about the comic, I'm just going to leave it at that, that there are maybe some similarities there, that, but yeah, I'm not going to give away whether that is the case in the movie. And, you know, even in like early trailers, certainly in trailers, they mention, like, the collateral damage from basically every of these movies of like, you know, yeah, of really big thing, you know, from starting with Avengers and, you know, the first Avengers film, not anything prior to that. But in the trailers and in the film, they don't mention London from Thor the Dark World. I figure it's because Thor isn't in it, and they didn't want to, yeah. They do actually point out the fact that Thor and Hulk are not in. Basically, they tell General Ross, we don't know where Thor or Hulk are. And he's like, if I lost two nuclear warheads, people would be pretty upset with me. And it's, point and match. And, you know, that in every MCU film that has Thor, it, you know, it makes sure you know whether or not he's going to stay on Earth or go back to Asgard after the film, you know, near the end of the film. It's going to establish whether, you know, and it's almost always Asgard anyway, but, you know, personally, I love that's, you know, that's a big part. But I can see why some people might think it's kind of lame. But yeah, Thor is presumably busy with Ragnarok. We don't know exactly what that is or what, you know, but Yeah, by the, you know, when that comes out, we'll probably see why he was unable to join. And given that Hulk isn't, you know, not no Thor, no Hulk, that means there are fairly few really destructive superpowers in this. You know, you have Vision, and then you have the Iron Man tech. Other than that, it's, you know, more or less human beings, maybe like super strength, super speed, and the like. And, you know, it is the first MCU film to really openly focus on, you know, heroes fighting each other. And there is a, yeah, there are winners and losers, and there is a, excuse me, a side, excuse me, that genuinely does come out on top, and I'm not gonna give away what it is. But yeah, you know, much like in the comic, it does actually call it. And yeah, it's, you know, at consistent failure to create compelling villains, you know, the producers just went, you know what, just pit the heroes against each other. Those are the interesting characters anyway. I reread the comic and I have not played Marvel Ultimate Alliance 2, which is actually an adaptation of the comic as well. But I love X-Men Legends 2, Rise of Apocalypse, and Marvel Ultimate Alliance 1. The X-Men game being the spiritual predecessor to these two games. I did not get around to playing Marvel Ultimate Alliance because when I eventually realized, hey, I've got the game, I could play, you know, by then, you know, when I installed it, I realized, you know, when I tried to install it, rather, did not work, and I didn't get around to getting a copy that worked in time. I did rewatch Age of Ultron and, you know, confirmed, just, you know, it wasn't like a fluke. No, that movie's absolutely amazing. And I wanted to remind myself of the best and worst of both previous Spider-Man continuities. So I watched Spider-Man 3 and The Amazing Spider-Man 2. The former with the riff tracks, which I continue to use as my excuse for having gotten Spider-Man 3. It was on sale anyway. And I rewatched Iron Man 1 again, you know, I own it, so it's, yeah. And The Incredible Hulk in order to compare General Ross's. And I was going to rewatch Ant-Man, but I was a little too late to get it from libraries, like nine other people in line before me. So other than that, I have watched everything in the MCU at least twice. You know, some considerably more. And it's possible that this movie will do better than Batman v Superman simply because Spider-Man is in it. He has been called the most profitable and/or popular superhero, and you know, he is right up there as one of the most recognizable. And yeah, it's an amazing Spider-Man. And he grabs Cap's shield in the comic as well. I'm not the first to say, but I am thrilled to be able to confirm this is the best Spider-Man live action that we've, yeah, so far. Just Straight up, the Russos say they went for the, you know, the most logical and practical, you know, take on the character for a live action, and that, you know, more so than we had gotten before. And yeah, it's just and you know, they do actually address in the film, you know, Marisa Tomei is Aunt May in this film as well. Not, you know, we won't have to wait before the, you know, for the solo film to, yeah. And they, yeah, they address it. They don't shy away from the fact that, yeah, she's, you know, I mean, she could be an aunt. I don't know if the actress is in real life, but, you know, she could be, but she's very different from what we think of when we think Aunt May. And the also won't be the first to say, but can indeed confirm, the Spider-Man intro is a bit forced. It's less convenient, you know, it's not as, you know, overly conveniently done as the previous Spider-Man. Yeah. And some have said that, like, it's too much CG. There's, you know, there are times where it's most definitely, you know, the actual actor there in the suit. I didn't think that they went over, you know, that they used CG too much, but then, you know, that's the Russos for you. And it's, you know, just every element that I wanted to see if Spider-Man is in there, and just, yeah, they get it all so right. And even, you know, even with a very different May, it's still, they still do very much have that kind of, you know, relationship of, she's very protective of him and, you know, clearly cares about him a ton, and he also, you know, also protect him, also cares, and he is, you know, he has to keep the secret, and yeah. Now, someone said that this can't quite match the emotional or intellectual punch of Captain America 2. I suppose so. Although, I'm not entirely sure it's supposed to quite go for that same. It is, you know, where that is very much kind of Steve's, you know, relationship with the U.S. government, and yeah. In this, it is more his relationship with Tony. You know, it does also go into the relationship between Steve and the U.S. government, but that, you know, relationship has been changed dramatically by Captain America 2. And this was written by the writers of Captain America 2, Thor 2, all three Narnias, Pain and Gain, and I, you know, I've only watched the MCU films in what I've just listed, but yeah, they do a great job yet again, as they did in the two MCU ones. There are some nice subversive narrative choices. There are some real twists and turns that I did not expect. The story did some very different things than what I had expected. And it is It is basically overstuffed, as I mean, the really it's I'm not sure the MCU is gonna get out of being overstuffed. I mean, I suppose you could say it's more or less it's pretty much been since the end of phase one that, yeah, you know, they're not all equally overstuffed, and I suppose it's not quite that the next film is necessarily more overstuffed, because Ant-Man wasn't that overstuffed, whereas, and Thor the Dark World wasn't really either, but, you know, Captain America 2, An Age of Ultron, and this, very much, yeah, but I maintain that it doesn't really feel, there's almost nothing that doesn't have enough, like, there isn't really any of it where I feel like, well, that should have just been cut entirely. Now, you know, some have said it's the best comic book film since The Dark Knight. I love The Dark Knight. I am not entirely sure that that one really has been topped. That movie is going for such a different thing from what a lot of the MCU. I'm not sure I'd necessarily say that it's, but, you know, I mean, I do consider there are some of these that are truly just like absolutely amazing, and really, you know, like that, where those specific movies almost couldn't have been any better, and they were just, you know, and on that list, still, you know, both Avengers films, Captain America 2, and yeah, also this. You know, I'm still not 100%. I really want to add Guardians to it. If Guardians didn't have so much exposition, where it's just, if they had released it and just cut the parts where they say where we are now is, and then just all this stuff about, yeah, then I might have added to the list. And Iron Man 3 comes very close, but I'm still, there are definitely problems with Iron Man 3. I think Spoonie is the one who most really notes the things that, what he points out as problems are the things that, yeah, that I would note as well. Now, some say it doesn't take any risks, since, you know, it has to, yeah, you know, there's still a bunch more MCU films that it has to kind of ensure the future for. I can see what they mean by that. And for sure, I mean, there is very, you know, if you watch this and you don't think that there's at all a, you know, some, in some places, kind of the producer saying, okay, to here and no further, because we need that character for... Yeah, obviously that is there, but the movie doesn't feel it, and there are definitely times... Like I said, things are not going to be the same after this movie, and... Yeah, I'm very interested to see how they're going to... Yeah, how the follow-up on this one. I should say that is one thing that is very, very clear in Iron Man 3 is studio intervention. Iron Man 2 as well. Poor Tony. That is very much, you in this, it doesn't really feel like they were handed, like, specific, you know, they may well have been, but I didn't feel like there were times in this where it seemed like something had been changed or added because the producers wanted, you know, you could argue the Spider-Man scene, but it doesn't feel like something that they were made to do more. It feels like something that they had to do at the last minute kind of thing, but it doesn't feel, you know, the Russos most definitely wanted Spider-Man in this thing. That's very clear. The how they use Spider-Man is just, yeah, that he was not forced upon them at all. It was more like they, you know, they were just sitting around the phone waiting for, you know, to be allowed to use him. That, I mean, I am grateful. I am grateful to... I'm grateful to Sam Raimi for having made Spider-Man 3, because it meant that we got The Amazing Spider-Man 1 and 2, and I am grateful to Mark Webb for giving us The Amazing Spider-Man 2, because it meant that we get the MCU Spider-Man, and yeah, it just, the Homecoming cannot come home soon enough. Now, this goes into themes of civil rights, freedom versus national security, and totalitarianism. In the comics, the secret identities are a big deal, both in general, and it's a major element of the registration, or in this case, the accords. And, you know, the MCU, the identities aren't that hidden. You know, I am Iron Man, you know, and from, it's not really, they don't really have a lot of secret identity, kind of, yeah. But it just isn't really a part of the accords in this. The, you know, more it's this kind of thing of basically, you know, I'll go into that a little later. The Russos managed to give us vital breathing room in between the big battles. And some people say that we haven't seen Steve and Tony in the MCU be friends. We haven't seen that a lot, but we know that they've been working together. They've both been in the Avengers, you know, for years. And when they work especially well together, you can tell that they are friends. You know, they can both be frustrating and difficult to be around, but you know, Steve doesn't have a lot of friends, but he treats them really well. Tony has a handful of friends, you know, and is a handful with his friends, but he clearly does care about them. Really, in the MCU, we only really see the major dramatic events between them, and yeah, because of that, you know, it doesn't look, you don't see as much, you know, the friendship doesn't have as much screen time as the dramatic because we are seeing stories. You know, you fill in the blanks. Like I said earlier, you know, Wanda, Scarlet Witch, is now, you know, basically a spy operative, which is, you know, hugely different from, you know, where we saw her in Age of Ultron, how, you know, where she was in her life. And yeah, it's time has passed in between, and when the film shows us this is how things are now, we realize, okay, so in the time that's passed that I haven't seen, that's, you know, that has happened. You know, I mean, we knew that Scarlet Witch was going to be an Avenger, but you know, we and that's also, you know, maybe it's the Russos. I don't know if that's going to carry over to the Infinity Wars as well, but you know, so far the two movies, you know, Steve very much a spy, and you know, Black Widow as well. Now the you know, and this, of course, in this film, you know, might we be seeing, you know, Tony work with Steve in the MCU for the last time? And you know, yeah, it's not exactly a secret that Iron Man will be in Avengers 3, at the very least, the first part of it. You know, the Yeah, they're not gonna get rid of him for, you know, at first he wasn't even going to be in this movie, but you know, when it became a Civil War adaptation, he became part of it and then quickly became a much bigger part of it than he was going to be at first. Now, in this, you know, it's very much, you know, you don't really know if Bucky is still a killer. You know, it's, you know, maybe he has his memory back, some, or you know, rediscovering his previous identity. Nevertheless, he was a killer, and he was one for decades. So yeah, it's not exactly like, you know, that's not something that changes overnight. In the trailers, we've seen Steve respond. I'm not going to say exactly what he is responding to, but you know, Tony basically saying, you know, come on, you know that my side is right, or you know, whatever. And Steve just responds, yeah, you just keep telling yourself that. Burn. See, when Steve just burns you, it's, man, he just yeah. And you know, there will be some, you know, maybe shooting at someone and they can like use their hand to, you know, maybe stop the bullet or the like. And given that Scarlet Witch is not, you know, English is not her first language, I do hope that the Sokovia Accords, you know, have non-English copies of, you know, a copy that states for you foreigners that translates as. And, you know, the war machine is finally in a film that isn't an Iron Man film, you know, and heck, this time it's not even an Avengers film. And, you know, this should inspire faith in, you know, anyone who still thinks that the Russo brothers cannot handle, you know, Avenger 3 parts 1 and 2. Yeah, I'd say, you know, I was certain that they could even before watching this, but yeah. Again, I don't quite know, you know, if is it going to be like a political spy thriller, because that's what both of their Captain America films have very much been, but you know, nevertheless, for sure, you know, the action, the tension, you know, the tight plotting, you know, and having a number of major characters. And this is, you know, the first non-Joss Whedon MCU film with a lot of costume characters. And yeah, the Russo brothers handled them, you know, about as well as Whedon did, you know, amazing. You know, it's easy to follow the actions of, you know, either team and, you know, their progress, what, you know, their planning, how it all comes together. And all of the costume characters have, you know, memorable and significant bits of, like, action. The, you know, the airport scene is obviously, yeah, just, it's difficult to pick just one. Really, it does a really good job of giving everybody action. I mean, there's maybe some that have a little bit more than others. You know, it is Steve's film, and Bucky is right there as, you know, top priority. It's very much Steve trying to protect and help Bucky. But yeah, you know, everyone has action scenes, and everyone does something really cool and compelling in the action. The, you know, the technology that the different members have, you know, not all of them, but the ones that do. And we get some cool, you know, Iron Man tech that, yeah, that we hadn't seen before. And the character, just, yeah, moments of character. There's this, yeah, Steve is trying to protect and help Bucky. And Sam is, of course, you know, right there, you know, that's, yeah, it's, they work together closely again, and they, you know, they have this really close relationship. And now Bucky is he's kind of the third wheel, and there's just these great little moments, like there's Steve has been driving the three of them. And then there's this bit where Steve isn't in the driver's, you know, he's out of the car, and the other two are just sitting there, and like I think it's Sam saying, actually I forget which, but it's like, can you move your seat? And it's just they're really getting on each other's nerves, and it's just, yeah, it's a lot of fun. And the, you know, and everybody's characterized, right? And there's development, you know, there are, yeah, character relationships change over the course of it. And there are some characters here that are meeting each other for the first time. And there are some really telling, you know, some exchanges that maybe have a very different context from their initial setup. And just, yeah, the MCU just really rewards paying attention, you know, even, yeah, especially in these films where it all, you know, where there are a lot of characters. Exploration of the characters, the various abilities. Cap shield is again used incredibly well. Honestly, this is probably where it has, yeah, I don't know how they did it. I don't know how the Russos did it, but this is probably the one where there is the most compelling and telling uses of Cap's shield. How he uses it, how other characters respond, what situations, I really did not think that Age of Ultron could be topped. And Captain America 2, for that matter, also had some. But, yeah, it just, that's the thing. They keep building and building. And I'm not, I suppose at some point the MCU will, I don't really know what they're going to do after Phase 3. And, you know, I don't know, maybe, I don't know, but I will, the moment that it collapses, the moment that they genuinely make a mistake, I will be honest about it. The Incredible Hulk turned out to be, you know, they have all but retconned it. In this, I mean, there aren't that many things said in this especially that say that, you know, that prevent the Incredible Hulk from being canon. But if at all you are, you know, I mean, it's the same, it's the same actor, but these are two, completely different takes on Ross. So anyway, and you know, I fully admit that Iron Man 2 is genuinely a bad movie, and other than that, the MCU does not have a single actually bad movie. Just not all of them are equally good. And definitely some are, you know, have a number of problems, but yeah. Falcon has this drone called Redwing, and in the comics, that, you know, Redwing is Falcon's pet falcon. You know, in the comics, he can communicate with birds. Every so often, in the MCU, they will hint at something that's in the comics. And yeah, in this, like very early on, when you see Redwing, like, Sam helps Black Widow through you know, by using Redwing. And she's like, thanks, Sam. And then he's like, don't thank me. And she's like, I'm not thanking that thing. And he's like, it's called Redwing. You know, and it's just, yeah, you know, if you watch the movie and you don't know that in the comics, Falcon can communicate with birds, that's not necessarily, you know, you're just going to be like, oh, that's weird. That's quirky. That's a fun little trait from the, but you know, those of us who are like, yeah, that probably wouldn't work in the movies. You know, that was legit. I was not sure if they were at all going to have any communicating with birds in MCU Falcon, because that is, yeah, you know, comic book Falcon, and there are strange things that they managed to fit in the films, but not all of them, and yeah. And it's also good, this is not Falcon's first film, so now that Falcon is just part of the team, yeah, he can have this drone, you know, those who have watched his first film know how he got his equipment in that one. And yeah, the various costume characters' competencies, their interactions, you know, the way they work together, and you know, scenes will really turn based on what one character can do and does do, and they really show us things that we, you know, that we really badly want as fans. You know, I worry that there might be too many brand new characters in this one. And again, I don't know how they do it, but yeah, the Russos managed to make them all fit. You know, Spider-Man is the only one where it does feel a little forced, but yeah. Which is not to say, he has plenty of an impact and a presence in the film. It's not like a last minute reshoot kind of thing. And, you know, might also worry that this would be too busy setting up future films. There definitely are some things that, you know, are set up for the future, but yeah, again, it's not really at the expense of, yeah, the current film, as it were. And the, you know, Tony quips in basically every MCU film that he's in, and in this, they even pointed out, the other characters, he's very subdued. Like, this is the most, of all the times we've seen the MCU Tony Stark, this is the one that is the most tempered and really just, yeah, you know, he's scared, and he, yeah, really hurt. There are some quips. It's not quite like Joss Whedon-y, but yeah, and you know, Ant-Man is, you know, his movie was very, you know, very much a comedy, and you know, you could tell that it I forget his name, Edgar Wright, that it was originally his film. But see, that would have been, you know, if they had actually put out an Edgar Wright film, that would not have fit into the MCU. But yeah, you know, the kind of lighter tone and that kind of thing, you know, that, yeah, he has that here as well. And he fits in. You know, there's some drama and sadness in his movie as well. So yeah, he still fits in. Now, the, you know, there are, at times it is a dark film, you know, a lot like Captain America 2. You know, it's not The Incredible Hulk dark, it's not Mark Millar grim dark, but you know, there's definitely, you know, phase 2 darkness to it. In the comics, and this, you know, this was something I wondered about when Age of Ultron happened, if that was, you know, and in this, especially now that there's time and space for it, in the comics, Scarlet Witch and Vision date, you know, and they do so here as well. You know, he tries to like cook for her, to, you know, as, yeah. And as you know, if you've, you know, looked up, you know, who's on what side, they are on opposing sides in this, and they do fight, and it's, yeah. And, you know, there's some Black Widow versus Hawkeye, you know, like in Avengers 1 as well. But in this, it's, you know, more of a, for real, you know, those were different circumstances. And yeah, it's this thing of, you know, old friends, colleagues. And, you know, that is something that Black Widow can actually, you know, that I wondered if it would be, I suppose I shouldn't say, but, you know, maybe Black Widow blames Scarlet Witch for Hulk leaving, and, you know, they are, again, they are on opposing sides. So, you know, that's something that Scarlet Witch can, that Black Widow can argue, in, you know, before General Ross. You wanted Hulk on? He's out. You know, and you know, like I say, they don't really go into, you know, is General Ross like happy that, you know, that Black Widow got, you know, that the Hulk wasn't with his daughter because of Black Widow? That's not, you know, brought up at all. But, you know, they do mention that, you know, maybe Scarlet Witch is, you know, yeah, I should leave that. But yeah, you know, the Black Widow could, you know, say, yeah, there we go, Hulk is gone. Who else? Bucky, he's out of my league. But nevertheless, point someone out, I will fall in love with them. Scarlet Witch will screw up their mind, have them flying off on a Quinjet. Tony will pay, he's made of money. Dude could probably actually create a tree that, you know, money would grow on. And, you know, I wondered if it would bring up, you know, Tony missing, broing out and doing science, mad or otherwise, with Bruce, but that, you know, they don't really go into that. And the, you know, the Sam Steve bromance does continue. And, you know, the, yeah, the, as I've already somewhat said, General Ross is not OTT here as he is in The Incredible Hulk, albeit it's the same actor. You know, when you're working with This Is Madness from 300, hammy acting does follow, but, you know, maybe with the Hulk gone, the thrill is gone. Where's the passion? What, you know, what can he get excited about now that he can't get back with that ex that he clearly can't get over? I mean, look at that face. What's William? Hurt. And, you know, he's still kind of not a fan of costume characters. Now, the... you know, with the MCU taking over, we will finally get a Spider-Man movie where the title isn't in the Sony font. I kind of wish that instead of a number, the, you know, the second Mark Webb Spider-Man movie had gotten like a nice pretentious subtitle, preferably starting with an R, like Requiem or something, because in that case the movie's shortening would be something like ASMR, and then I could make like a dumb joke about how I like the sound of that title. They genuinely went the whole way, you know, the whole nine yards on this one with Spider-Man. They legit cast a kid. You know, maybe that's why his solo movie's out in a few years. He has to, you know, become like legal age first. It is the first time a, you know, a kid has played the you know, the character in live action, and it does make sense because he is playing a kid. You know, it is the original Spider-Man, you know, teenage Peter Parker, high school, you know, Peter Parker. And, you know, yeah, he was in high school in some of the other films. Nevertheless, it was, you know, he was not played by a kid before. At times, very obviously not played by a kid before. And this kid can actually do acrobatics. He has a background in that. And, yeah, it really seemed to help out in the fight scenes. And, yeah, you know, he's cracking jokes. He's very much a teenager, and he's basically just trying to help people. He almost says, like, the, you know how in The Amazing Spider-Man, they kind of rephrase with great power? In this, they almost do the same. I don't know if, like, I don't know too many details about the solo Spider-Man movie, but they almost don't even need to do the origin story, because they practically, I mean, they don't say out loud the full origin, but in this, he, you know, he's asked why, you know, why are you doing this? And he pretty much just does say, but yeah, it just, the you know, they get it. The Russos get it, and whoever else was responsible on this, they get it. That they I mean, it's almost like if it wasn't stuff that you're really glad it's also in the movie, it's almost like they are, like, you know, just doing, you know, flips and twirls on the other side of the finish line. It's like, okay, we get it. You're really good at this. And the, you know, I really wasn't sure that I was gonna like the casting anywhere near as much as Andrew Garfield, but they just he nails it. He has just the physicality, the voice, the attitude, the kind of, he'll crack jokes, but he'll also like be really he'll get super over eager and like really like yeah, it's in the like TV spots and such, and it's not like a big spoiler. He goes up against the Winter Soldier, and he's like, "You have a metal arm? That's awesome!" And just yeah, he's like that the whole way, and they just yeah, spot on. And the in the comics, Spider-Man is the one is the outside character who's caught in the middle between Steve and Tony. In this, it is Black Panther who was always in the comic. And yeah, it does really work. It doesn't feel like Black Panther's character, they very clearly, very deliberately wrote this as Black Panther. It's also, it's before his solo movie, so it has some of his like some maybe kind of origin story kind of stuff, but yeah. And the as such, Black Panther's choices and who he sides with and what he does and such greatly affects the outcome, like with Spider-Man in the comic. And of course, this does mean that we do not get the hilarious J. Jonah Jameson reaction to the unmasking, which I would love to see J.K. Simmons do. And, much like Batfleck, Black Panther also has, short ears on a mask, this black costume, incredibly well trained in martial arts, incredibly smart, the, capable, compelling leader of something that, his father led before him, the first kind of, a first for a type of person or such to become a hero. And, in the comics, he's like one of the eight smartest people, on Earth. He's like fiercely well educated, and some like Captain America, incredibly skilled martial artists and from, a drug or something, super speed, strength, agility, and stamina. And his uniform is vibranium. He's got vibranium claws. It makes sense. Vibranium comes from his country. And this is the first thing I see Chadwick Boseman in, and yeah, he absolutely nails it. I mean, the character goes through a lot of stuff, and and again, it's his first movie, and he also has this really pivotal role to play, and yeah, he absolutely nails it. And it's kind of we don't quite know where he stands on things, and yeah, and he's trying to figure out he's there are these themes with him of like living up to traditions, what his father expects, the legacy of the nation of Wakanda, how things were done in the past, how things are done in the present, and yeah. And the Black Panther costume is a mix of practical and visual effects. And the bit where where Steve holds a helicopter to stop it from lifting off. Yeah, that's absolutely amazing in the film. At, you know, they didn't give away too much in the trailer. Yeah, it's an amazing image. Sharon slash Agent 13 slash Emily Van Camp. In Captain America 2, I was like, if there's maybe one character too many, she's probably the one. She still kind of is here. It's just there's not really particularly room for, and it's also just she could have been, you know, what she does could have been done by other characters, and it didn't really, yeah. And in this, it is revealed that she is related to Peggy Carter. And hypothetically, if this movie does have a romance between her and Steve, the movie does not really do anything to make that not be kind of ew. And, you know, I wondered if, you know, now that Ultron has happened and Hank Pym is part of the MCU, you know, Hank Pym is not in this movie, but, you know, the current Ant-Man is. You know, I wondered if maybe it would be, you know, pointed out that, you know, Tony stole Hank's thunder, but yeah. And Martin Freeman is in this as also a Ross, but this one is Everett Kay, a, you know, kind of political, he's, you know, working on the Accords, and yeah, he's not much in this. He's not in this much. It's more or less set up. He's a supporting character of Black Panther, and you know, with that you might almost think that, well, you know, he didn't really need. He's perfectly fine. It didn't, you know, he maybe didn't need to be there, but he doesn't really take up much time or anything. And apparently he's supposed to be, in the comics, he's supposed to be based on Chandler. I did not watch Friends, and that is not something I have to justify in any way, but just briefly checking out Chandler, I can kind of see, you know, they don't do much of that here, but I could see how Martin Freeman can go for that kind of thing, especially as the character's written here. It's, you know, he's not quite, it's a little, I really, really like him in the, which I also really, really like, the Hobbit trilogy. But yeah, in that, he's maybe a little more like almost helpless than he is here. Here he is more serious of a, and really these are the only two things I've ever seen Martin Freeman in. But yeah, ultimately, I mean, it's not much less shoehorned in than Claw in, yeah. In the comics, the, you know, the Registration Act is basically like a draft for superheroes. And that is, you know, in part what, I mean, here, it is specifically for the Avengers, but it is kind of saying, you know, there'll be like, yeah, you know, the it's a law ratified by, you know, I think they say it's 117 countries of, you know, in the UN, and just, yeah, so it's, yeah. And in the comics, Luke Cage goes as far as to compare it to slavery, which is maybe a tad too far, but yeah, it did kind of want to go for the, you know, this kind of, yeah, the comics Civil War wanted to push buttons. You know, you can, it's supposed to make you think of stuff like the Patriot Act, you know. Now, I've seen pointed out that, you know, in the comics, it basically makes sense to have registration, you know, that, you know, you could compare it to regulation of, you know, cars, and to the extent that they still are regulated, guns, you know, so why not regulate costume characters as well? And that's something I think, you know, that's a really good, the fact that the MCU went with S.H.I.E.L.D. as the kind of the boss of the Avengers is really clever. Now it's, you know, now when Steve says, you know, that he doesn't really trust the kind of, yeah, that, you know, the government for that, he can base it on, you know, look what happened with S.H.I.E.L.D. And, you know, yeah, people online have raised why, you know, why do they let it go to fighting? You know, and that is, yeah, the comic storyline of Civil War has these problems in abundance. The film does a lot to address them, but yeah, you know, why are they fighting? Why don't they just talk it out? And I would say the film does a good job of, you know, yeah, of making that work better than the comics do. And, you know, in this, in the film, unlike the comic, Tony does not go like completely, you know, crazy with, you know, going in the direction of the registration. But there are, you know, there are sacrifices to be made if he wants to be the, you know, yeah, if he wants to take that side. And yeah, you know, as such, it was pretty clear to a lot of people that the comics were problematic, and, you know, you would, you know, yeah, it would be beneficial, maybe even necessary, to improve on them, but how could you? Melodramatics aside, I don't want to give too much away in this. I'm gonna start the thoughts video on that, but yeah. And like with Captain America 2, the action is mainly practical and absolutely amazing, and they learn their lesson from Captain America 2. In this, the action is not cut too fast. It was, I forget, I want to say it was Last Angry Geek who pointed out it was just cut slightly too fast. It was a just touch too much, and yeah, it's not at all the case in this. And as others have noted, it's fun, fun without being fluffy, has consequences without being dire. For the tone, they said a mix of the brothers said that it would be a mix of the previous, the first two Captain America movies, and yeah, I can somewhat see that. And they said, it would be like a psychological thriller, with influences of Seven, Fargo, The Godfather, Westerns, Brian De Palma movies. And yeah, to an extent, it is very much this kind of core. Yeah, it is driven by the conflict between Tony and Steve, and with Bucky as this really major piece in that. And it is, in ways funnier, more comedic, and with more lighter, more light moments than Captain America 2, as they also point. Reviewed other parts of this franchise, the links are in the description box. Please comment, thumbs up, and subscribe for more content.